All right, everyone. So today I am doing my first ever actual tutorial video. Very exciting. This request was requested on my Instagram after I did a watercolor silhouette painting. Very simple, actually. It just really helps if you know some tips and tricks that I'm going to show you guys in a step-by-step today. What you're gonna need is some watercolor paper. I don't really use any, let's see, 140-pound. It's actually not that thick. Just make sure that it can hold the water that we're gonna be using. I mean, literally, this is the cheapest kind of watercolor paper that you can get from Michaels. So I'm using this. I picked out my watercolors. I used Dr. P.H. Martin's Radiant Concentrated Watercolors. Come in here and get a shot of those bad boys. Yep, there we go. I made a color chart a long time ago. And so I just looked on here and found the colors that I want. I'm going to use the ice green, and I'm going to use the chartreuse, April green, and then I'm going to pick a slightly darker color to create some contrast in the grass green. So we're going to be using those. Anyways, I use a watercolor brush pen. It's pretty cool. It just holds your water in here. It's clear. I mean, it may not look like it, but it comes out clear. You essentially don't need a water cup or anything if you're using similar colors, but this is really handy. I have a tiny little paintbrush for fine details, and I have an eraser stick, which really helps with these edges. I mean, you can totally use an eraser on a regular pencil, but I just prefer using this so I don't grind down my actual pencil eraser a lot. A somewhat, I would say, medium-tipped paintbrush. Other supplies we have right here. Let's see if this will focus. Oh, let's do it this way, shall we? All right, so I have a fine line. It's a masking fluid pen. So it has this really fine tip, as you can see here, which is great for doing like this fine line work for painting a mask around the silhouette that we're gonna be doing. All right, and then pencil, water for watercolors. I just have paper towels for any blotting that we're gonna do to soak up the extra ink. And that is pretty much it. So I've already gone ahead and picked the drawing that I want to do. I'm doing Pidge from Voltron. I'm doing a whole series of them. And I already found the picture that I wanted to do. This cute picture of Pidge. Let me zoom in here. Yeah, right about there. Yes, so that's what I'm doing. When you're looking for pictures to do a silhouette of, you're really trying to find something that is going to look good, solid, and as an outline. I was experimenting yesterday and I found some that didn't really work as well as I was hoping, especially if there's like some complicated arm movements or hands like in front of the face. Like, you're not going to be able to tell that once the picture is just a solid color. So think about that. Once you draw the outline, if, you know, the picture still makes sense to you, then great, we can proceed. All right, so I just outlined this in pencil, really light pencil. I'm gonna go ahead and just fix a few of these little fine details so I know exactly where I'm gonna paint my mask around. All right, and I'm actually gonna do something a little bit different with the Bayard right here. I'm gonna erase my lines because I'm going to do a kind of a splatter effect. But I would suggest, if this is your first time, especially if you haven't worked with paint splatters or anything, to keep a solid outline for yourself. It's gonna make things a little bit easier. And I have a little bit of room over here and over here for some text that I'm gonna do. All right, so now we're going to go in with the fine line masking fluid pen and get it going just a little bit. All right, and we're just going to mask our outline. If you do not have a lot of control with your watercolors, if you don't feel like you're that experienced drawing a thicker outline, not thicker as in like piled on top of each other, but thicker as in like wider space around. Go ahead and do that. I'm just gonna do a thin amount because I can control the watercolors pretty well. If you don't get too crazy, this should be good for you. So like I was saying, if you need to like come all the way out here because you want to be triply, quadruply sure that you're not going to bleed outside this mask, then absolutely go for it. And you really want to make sure that there's no pencil on the inside of this area, especially if you're using lighter colors. Because you probably won't be able to erase it later. Same goes with the outline. Just try and get as clean of an outline as you possibly can. And I really like this fine liner pen for these really small details. Because painting this on with like regular masking fluid and a paintbrush is really frustrating and doesn't work very well a lot of the time, in my experience. But maybe that's just me. Especially on these tight little corners like this, I like to kind of glob a little bit like over here and then drag it in towards the center. Otherwise, if you glob it in right in the center there, it's not going to create that really fine angle for you. Is starting to get really globby. So I'm gonna kinda get rid of that excess. So I'm doing this little hair part right here, which is really fine. So make sure the tip is really clean before you go in there. Like just wipe it off real quick. Alrighty, that's about as good as we're gonna get for that. I'm gonna go in, maybe try and take a little off. Okay. And diamonds, jewels behind the throne, into the light, out of the dark, take to the sky, chasing the stars, all that we said. As you can see, when it turns really darker, like around the outsides right here, it's already starting to dry, which is good. I think it usually takes, I would say, especially if you're doing it thin enough, because you really don't need to make this really thick. Like I said, wider is better. Don't like build it up. It's gonna take forever to dry and it might rip your paper, especially if you're using thinner paper. But if it's a relatively good, pretty thin layer, it takes about 10 to 20 minutes probably to dry completely. And you need to wait for it to dry completely before we put any of the watercolors on. Hide and seek, reason and rhyme, grand and glorious, living the dream, yours and mine. And for these little blank areas that you know are going to be completely white, I like to pretty much fill those in completely so I can just put the color over everything and just make it a lot easier that way. Really spread it thin. You don't need a thick coat. There we go. All right, so I'm going to add in one more little spot over here that I forgot to do in my outline. Okay, so I've gone in and draw this other little accent that I wanted to do. I think that little accents like this that are gonna stay white in the center of this color of the silhouette looks pretty cool. Gives it a little more dimension and interest. Gotta get close because I'm a little blind. Okay, so that is all done. We're gonna replace our cap. Always replace the cap or else your masking fluid is going to dry out. So now we get to wait for this to completely dry. So we're just gonna let that dry. We're gonna come back, I'd say about 15 to 20 minutes, and then we get to color, the exciting part. If you're thinking of using a heat gun or something like that, that might help the masking fluid dry faster, I would advise against it. In my experience, it really like heats so much to the point that it glues this stuff to the paper, and maybe it's just because I use cheap paper. I'm not really sure, but I mean, go ahead and try it, but I would advise against it personally, just in my experience. All right, so now it's the fun part. We get to watercolor. So we're making sure that our lines here are completely dry. They're gonna be a little bit sticky still, but as long as it doesn't actually like peel off or come off on your fingers, and then you're good to go. And you should notice it's a little bit darker, more green color as opposed to yellow when you first put it on. All right, so the key to doing the kind of swirly paint splatter watercolory effect is you want to get the whole surface that you'll be coloring wet before you even put the watercolors down. So, and you want to do this kind of a pretty generous layer. I mean, you don't want to put a flood on your paper. So I'm just gonna go in here, and since it's clear water, obviously you're not really gonna be able to tell at first where all the water is, but if you lift up your paper and kind of look at it, you'll be able to tell if you hit some light on there where water hasn't reached yet. So you want just enough water on there so that it doesn't instantly get absorbed by the paper, but not too much that it's like spilling over your lines. If that's the case, abort, mop up the water, wait for that to dry, and then go back in and do it again. Try a little bit less if you're messing that up. All right, you wanna make sure all of the lines are colored. All right, getting in here, coming back up here. All right, and for my special little area over here, I'm just gonna go up to about where the masking fluid is. Maybe a little bit farther. All right, go over here and do this arm. And if you get too much water on there, just spread. And like I said, this pen is really handy since the water's already in here. If you're just using a regular paintbrush, then just move the water around to evenly distribute it. Maybe if you have a little too much in some places and it's already being absorbed in others, taking care not to go out of the lines, otherwise your colors are going to bleed out of the lines instantly. All right, so pretty much done. I'm gonna check this up to the light. I'm going to, looking at the light, fill in some areas that maybe need a little bit more, because we want the watercolors to latch on to that water and just spread of their own volition. We don't really want to have to do anything. All right, so we're ready. I'm going to start with my lighter colors, and I have my chart here. Lightest color looks like ice green, and I have these handy dandy little droppers. If not, you're gonna just pour like glop in like your, what do you call it, your palette, and just get a big glop on your paintbrush and just drop it down. So we're just gonna kind of randomly drop these everywhere. Some up here, maybe a little bit more in some places if we want it to be a little bit darker. Make it down here. All let's do some chartreuse next. Yeah, okay, that's a nice darker color. Maybe I'll use that instead of my grass green. And if you see that some colors aren't moving kind of instantly on contact, that's where you can tell that the areas are drying faster. And we'll fix that in a minute. We'll go in and manually, I guess, make the colors go. So you gotta work fast. That's kind of the key with watercolors. And we're gonna do some April green here. I may even leave some more white in. Ooh, that's pretty. All right, see, that's what they should do. Stick here and there. We're gonna leave a little bit of white room so that we do have some room to move the colors ourselves. Because as we can see, there's like some puddles right here where it's a little too watery. And we want to be able to make sure all the colors get evenly distributed how we want. So I actually like that. I'm not gonna use my grass green. I'm gonna come back in really quickly with my brush, and we're gonna make sure we kind of spread everything to the edges first and foremost, make sure that everywhere has color. It's gonna tell right here it's a big puddle, so too much water. So I'm gonna go in and very gently just dab up this watercolor. Just a little bit of it, and in here we got a little bit too much too. Okay, I think everywhere else is pretty good. All right, I'm gonna go in here, make sure our lines are colored. So moving quickly, that is the key, and move the colors before they dry. It's the name of the game. Make sure that the watercolors are really around this area that is going to be whited out, because we really want that area to be defined once we remove the masking fluid. Okay, so I'm going to kind of make my little Bayard area right here. Ooh, I got a lot right here too that we're going to... Ooh, why is there so much over here? So when there's that much, you really want to mop it up, otherwise it's threatening to spill over. And we don't want that after we've done all this hard work over here. Ooh, see, that is about to spill over right there, so. Just a little bit, and you really want to try when you're sopping up this color not to let the paper towels drag too much, because that's gonna possibly have it spill over. All right, so I am actually going to add a tiny bit more water over here, and I'm gonna do a little effect. We're gonna see if that's gonna work. I'm gonna blow the watercolors. There we go. All right, that's really experimental. If you haven't done it before and you're just testing this out, go for it. If this is a nice piece you don't want to ruin and you've never done it before, maybe hold off until next time. I don't want to stem your creativity, but doing little splatters is kind of, it takes a little bit of experience, I would say. All right, so this is pretty much done. We're gonna go back in, just make sure all around these edges here are filled up to the masking fluid. Everything's looking pretty good. All right, I like it. Move some water around if it's a little sopping up a little bit too much. This area just is pretty heavy. Okay, and now we play that fun waiting game again. I would say that this usually takes a couple of hours to dry. Once again, I would suggest not using a heat gun because it can really make the masking fluid really gummy. So yeah, air dry is the best way to go for this, I would say. And yeah, so let it air dry, don't touch it. don't move it. And I will see you when this is dry. All right, so I actually have something that I was going to do. I just decided on the words that I'm gonna put on here. So to do this, I'm actually gonna drop some of my colors into here. Since I'm not gonna be able to use the dropper for this, that might be a little disastrous. Let's see, we're gonna use our April green and our chartreuse. I'm just going to use a thin little paintbrush here for this. All right, so we're gonna be doing the words tech guru, and I'm gonna try and kind of emulate this watercolor effect by grabbing the different colors and putting them in between my strokes here. Very careful not to get too much into that stuff, since I just did. If you do stick your hand in it, make sure it's wiped off before you go in again. If I had done this before, I colored the rest of this, but you live and learn. All right, so that's it for our words. And we're just gonna let that dry with the rest of it. That shouldn't take too long. Everything has completely dried. This is completely good. It's doing some sort of weird residue, but pretty much dry. It's all good. Masking fluid is definitely dry. So we're ready to start erasing the masking fluid to reveal the silhouette underneath. And I do a fine eraser. I really like my eraser pen thing. You can also use like a normal pencil eraser. Like I said, I just like using this one so that I don't do my pencil erasers down to little nubs. But you're just gonna slowly kind of chip away at it. You're not like hardcore erasing. You're kind of find an edge, pick it up. Let's zoom in a tiny bit. Try and do this. And just slowly kind of push it away. And if you try this and you're not positive that, you're not positive that maybe the masking fluid has dried yet and it's smearing color, as you're starting to peel this up, stop. The paint is definitely not dry yet, this paint, and just wait longer. So it'll be completely dry. There shouldn't be any color coming up if your painting is completely dry. So we're just gonna work our way around here. It's okay to kind of erase on the actual watercolors. Depending on what watercolors you use, it may be a slight discoloration. But these PH Martins are pretty good about that. And what you want to be careful of is when you're doing all this, if you start to peel and like it's not coming off, like you can erase pretty hard, I've found on most paper, or even use your finger to try and peel it up. But eraser's really gonna get everything off there. However, if you start to see little flecks of actual paper coming up, that's when you know that either the masking fluid you bought is not very great, or maybe if you used a heat gun, that might be what's happening. In that case, you just wanna be very, very gentle and slowly try and peel it off. Maybe with your fingers might be a little bit easier. You'll get big clumps after a while and I just peel those off, get them out of the way. Somebody broke me once, love was a currency, a shimmering balance act. Turning out pretty good so far. I saw your face and hands, covered in sun and then, I think I understand, well I understand. But we fight, stay up late, in my dreams. Different sides of the bed. Roll your eyes, shake my head. Now we're stuck in the
till I saw your face and hands covered in sun, and then I think I understand. Well, I understand. But we fight, stay up late in my dreams on the blade, different sides of the bed. Roll your eyes, shake my head. Now we're stuck.
Okay, so we finished cleaning up all of the masking fluid, and you can kind of rub your hands over here, make sure your hands are clean, and you can feel if there's still little pieces on here, you can kind of rub them to get rid of them, or if you feel an area, just go over it with your eraser again. This didn't come out necessarily as clean as I wanted it to. The camera doesn't really pick up. There's lots of like little residue, and for some reason it just wasn't coming off as easily as normal. So I really had to rub some of the areas really hard, and that was starting to peel up the paper a bit, which is not good. You have to stop when that happens. But for some of these areas, I'm gonna do a splatter over it. I'm also gonna take a paintbrush and kind of, I guess, fill in the details a bit more, make it look a little bit sharper overall. Sometimes if you're going up this way and it's not coming off, then maybe you scrub the other way, like horizontal instead of vertical, and sometimes that picks it up a little bit easier. Anyways, we're gonna clear all this off of here. All right, so now we're going to get ready for paint splatters, which is the fun part. And I'm actually gonna do those before I do all the details. Because sometimes some of the paint splatters you can use to kind of pull in to the details and not make it as obvious that they weren't part of the whole thing. Anyway, so I'm just gonna take my colors. We're just gonna do the April green and the chartreuse again, because those worked pretty good for this. We're gonna put some over in our little color wells over here. All right, green. And the key to doing paint splatters is, first of all, you want to do it in an area that you can literally don't care that splatters are going to get everywhere. So I'm actually, since it's raining out, I'm going to take this onto the kitchen. So there's a linoleum floor, so that can easily come off really quickly. But also you want quite a bit not necessarily pure color. You can add water to this, but you want to be able to get a significant kind of a glob on your paintbrush to be able to just tap it. It's gonna come off. Not too much, or else there's gonna be a big fat dot that just falls on there. But enough that, you know, if you hit it, it's gonna kind of splatter a little bit. So we're gonna go and do that now. Okay, so we're gonna do the paint splatters right now. Here I have my colors. And I'm actually just gonna take a spare little bit of paper here, because I should have left this covered before, but I do not want this little symbol to get covered in paint. So I'm going to cover that up and make sure that we're good for that. So we're going to get a fair amount of water on our brush. So like this. Let's go in with the, I think this is the chartreuse. Alright, so kind of a glob on there. Alright, and we're just going to go splatter. Just gently tapping the brush. You'll start to notice when it gets a bit more directional, there's maybe not as much on there, or you're hitting a little bit too hard. We're gonna get some of the darker stuff now. Light taps. You know, fair warning, it does get everywhere. That's kind of what's cool about it. And we're gonna do a little bit, get some more water, mix this a tiny bit, slightly different color. Thinking up here needs some more. Hitting it a little bit harder to get some a little bit bigger splatters. Maybe in here. Looks pretty good. One more of this lighter color because I like this. Some little bit of heavier hits here. Okay, that looks pretty good. If you want to make it a little more interesting, you can even just take plain water, a little bit on your brush, and just tap that on there a bit. That's going to make certain little splatter dots on the watercolor that you already did get a little bit lighter, absorb. So I'm gonna take my little fine brush here. There we go. I'm gonna go in, and while these paints are still kind of all wet and mixed together, I'm gonna go in and smooth out a couple of these silhouettes here. Hand is looking a little scarecrow-y. Don't be afraid to use the dots that are already on there to kind of take some watercolor from. So I'm going to put my signature on here. Go. All right. Close up of that. That's what it's looking like. All right. No wait to for that to dry. But that's pretty much it. That's saved. And you can feel free to add more splatters. Experiment with a bigger brush or a smaller brush. Doing more layers. I personally think there sometimes is such thing as too much paint splatters. I think I'm kind of on the verge of that right here. Maybe I'll add a couple more bigger ones. But that's totally personal opinion. For the most part though, we're done. And it's not all that hard, is it? It just takes a few times. Trial and error. Trial and error, but it's a relatively simple, and you can create some pretty unique and cool pieces of art. So I hope you guys liked this video. I hope it was informative. If you guys have better techniques than I do, feel free to share them. I would love to hear. Otherwise, I hope that this just helps somebody else out there. And I look forward to seeing the art that comes of it. So thank you guys. You can find me on Instagram as Art by Mo Potter, by that same name on Facebook, and Mo Potter on DeviantArt. If you want to chat about things such as Voltron or art in general, let me know if you guys are interested in any more tutorial videos, because it was actually pretty fun. Thanks guys for watching. Bye.